The knife attacks and killings attributed to a serial stabber, sometimes referred to as the Flint serial killer, are believed to have begun on May 24, 2010, a Monday, in Flint, Michigan. On that date, David Dwayne Motley, 31, was killed in an attack at approximately 6 a.m. on Leith Street and North Dexter Street. Police found his body in a residential yard a short time later after receiving a call about a man down. Motley had been stabbed repeatedly and died at the scene. All of the violent attacks appeared to have been committed on unsuspecting victims, and all of the victims seemed to have been strangers to the perpetrator. The victims, as far as police have so far announced, were mostly men with dark skin. Police are uncertain, though, whether the attacks were racially motivated or the victims picked out at random. Flint's population is predominantly black, so some authorities do not believe that the victims were chosen because of their race. Many of the surviving victims' names have not been released, some at their own request. The stabber's victims were outside at night, alone, and some were approached by their attacker using the ruse of either needing directions or help with a vehicle that had broken down. After gaining a victim's confidence, according to Flint Police Lieutenant T.P. Johnson, the attacker would then pull a knife and attack. "A knife is a very personal weapon," Johnson added. "To stab someone repeatedly, there has to be some rage going on." The victims injured or killed in the attacks ranged in age from as young as 15 to as old as 67. Although detectives had been investigating the violent crimes from the time they began, it would be more than 2 months before the pattern of the attacks became apparent to them. The second fatal attack came nearly a month later, on June 21, 2010, also a Monday, when Emmanuel Mohammed, 59, was knifed at approximately 2 a.m. on Wood Street and Avenue B in Flint. His body was found a short time later. Police had few clues and no suspects. At first, there was little to suggest that Motley's and Mohammed's deaths were linked, and at that time, there was no evidence that a serial killer was at work. The next stabbing occurred barely 5 days later, on Saturday, June 26, 2010, at 5:50 a.m., on the 1900 block of West Pearson Road in Flint. The life-threatening knifings now occurred in more rapid succession. Between June 26th and July 19th, assaults occurred roughly a week apart, sometimes less, and it began to appear that the mysterious, knife-wielding assailant could no longer control violent urges. Whatever was driving the attacks seemed to be growing stronger. On Sunday, July 4th, 2010, a white male, 20, was attacked by an unknown assailant on the 900 block of Vermilia Avenue in Flint. The only major difference in the attack was the victim's race. The next attack occurred in Burton, Michigan, a few miles east of Flint, on July 12, 2010, another Monday, in which a 29-year-old black man was attacked at 1:30 a.m. on Saginaw Road near Maple Avenue. A week later, on July 19, 2010, yet another Monday, the attacker took his violence a few miles northeast of Flint to Genesee Township. This time, Richard Booker, 49, a white male, was attacked at 1:30 a.m. on North Saginaw Road and Julia Avenue while on his way to a nearby store. Booker later told police, according to WILX 10 News, that a man standing next to a green Chevy Blazer asked him for help opening the vehicle's hood. "I'm beating on his hood trying to get it open," Booker said. "He takes a Bowie knife and sticks it right into my kidney and liver. Then he grabbed me around my neck." Booker showed reporters an 18-inch scar that extended from his chest to his pelvic area, and a smaller scar on his right side. He said that he lost 8 pints of blood. "He's a stone-cold killer," he said. "He knows what he's doing. He's trained in it. He knows where to stick you to kill you." Booker later told ABC News that it took 68 staples to his back and stomach to close the wounds, and that he had slash wounds to his arms because he tried to prevent his assailant from cutting off his face. "I've never hurt so much in my life, never came so close to death," Booker said. "I was about dead." Because he's white, Booker dismissed the idea that the stabbings were racially motivated. "I'm obviously not black," he said. "This guy's just a stone-cold killer." Seemingly compelled to attack increasingly frequently, the serial stabber apparently attacked another victim on Friday, July 23, 2010, a mere 4 days after the previous stabbing. This time, the victim was a 21-year-old black man attacked at 5:45 a.m. on the 100 block of University Avenue in Flint. 3 days later, on Monday, July 26, 2010, Darwin Marshall, 43, was stabbed at 1:25 a.m. on the 800 block of Garland Street near West 5th Avenue in Flint. He died a short time after being found. He lived in a North Side apartment with his mother and another relative and liked to sing in the congregation of the Ruth Street Church of God, founded by his grandfather. "It's a melody," his mother, Velma Marshall, said. "If he sang something for you, he would get your attention. He had a nice angel voice. He was wonderful. I don't say that just because I was his mother. He was a wonderful person. A lot of people loved him." He was an Army veteran and the father of two adult daughters. Following the July 26th attack, the serial stabber apparently began a streak of daily attacks. The next day, July 27th, Antoine Marshall, 26, was stabbed at 3 a.m. on Pearson Street near Fleming Road in Flint. He described an experience similar to Richard Booker's, with similar wounds, except that he was stabbed 6 times in his stomach and chest. Marshall said that he was on his way into his apartment when his assailant approached and asked for help fixing his car. When Marshall opened the vehicle's hood, he was stabbed, sustaining injuries to 3 of his organs and a long scar from his chest to his pelvic area. "When he was finished, he just walked off," Marshall said. The following day, a 19-year-old black man was stabbed at 3:30 a.m. on Cook Street, also in Flint. And the day after that, July 29th, a 59-year-old black man was stabbed at 6 a.m. on Saginaw Road and 12th Street. On Friday, July 30th, 2010, the serial stabber stepped up his pace once again and claimed 2 victims on the same day, one in Flint and the other in nearby Flint Township. The first was Frank Kellybrew, 60, a General Motors retiree who lived in the hometown inn, a Flint Township motel. Kellybrew's body was found in front of Italia Gardens restaurant on Miller Road near Lennon Road, not far from the motel, by a passerby. Recently purchased grocery items lay near his body. Police estimate the attack occurred around 3:30 a.m. John Henson, manager of the hometown inn, said that Kellybrew had walked across the freeway, Interstate 75, to make some purchases at a convenience store gas station. "He was a nice guy," Henson said. "He kept to himself. If he didn't know you, he would just avoid you and have nothing to do with you." Henson said that Kellybrew liked to sit on a bench near the Italia Gardens at night. "He'd just go over there and sit and relax," Henson said. "It's pretty quiet over here at night when everything closes. Frank didn't deserve what happened to him. It's just senseless." Kellybrew had been living at the hometown inn on a month-to-month basis since September 2009, according to Henson. Homicide investigators determined that Kellybrew was last seen walking west on Miller Road near Interstate 75. The second victim of July 30th was not identified by the police, but was described as a 28-year-old black male who was attacked at approximately 6 a.m. at an undisclosed location. The serial stabber now broke his pattern and did not attack anyone on July 31st, 2010. The violence resumed on Sunday, August 1st, 2010, though. That morning, 2 stabbings were reported to the Flint Police Department, an assault on Etwan Wilson, 17, at 2:30 a.m. on Cloverlawn Drive and Basil Lane. And later, a 25-year-old black man was stabbed at 6:15 a.m. in the 300 block of Bradley Avenue. Wilson, hospitalized from his injuries, would complain that it took the police several days to visit him in the hospital and question him about the attack. "I want to know why the Flint police never came to question me about anything that night," Wilson said. The police responded that it was their policy not to speak with a victim immediately after the victim has come out of surgery. The next 2 days passed without any stabbings. However, on Tuesday, August 3rd, 2010, Arnold Miner, 49, was found stabbed to death less than a mile from his home. He had been visiting his mother's home on Flint's north side and was walking home when he was killed in the area of several of the other attacks. Miner's sister, Stephanie Ward, said that she had offered her brother a ride home, but he had declined. "When they found him, he wasn't far from home," Ward said during a press conference outside Flint City Hall. "He bled to death on the street. You don't know what goes through someone's mind to do something like that." Arnold Miner was the second member of his family to have been murdered. An older sister had been killed 26 years earlier. Her killer had never been caught. "We're not going to lose another family member to an unsolved mystery," said relative Kareem Miner. "We are going to catch this individual," Flint Mayor Dane Walling said. in response to Kareem Minor at a press conference attended by Flint Police Chief Alvern Locke and Genesee County Prosecutor David Layton. Although detectives had been investigating each of the attacks that had occurred in Flint, it was not until after Minor's death, some 2 months after the attacks began, that a pattern became apparent to them. In concluding that the violent attacks that had occurred throughout the summer were not mere coincidence, police officials nonetheless declined to identify all the victims they linked to the attacker, and would at that time only say that the attacks dated back to May 24th. Citizens of this community have been victims of a series of unprovoked attacks, Layton said. These assaults may be related. These stabbings have been taking place during the early morning hours. The victims have been on foot and approached by the suspect in his vehicle. Oftentimes, the suspect is asking for directions or assistance. Mayor Walling urged city residents to remain vigilant and to look out for each other. If you have someone in your life who's vulnerable, look out for them, Walling said. Out of 16 attacks believed carried out by the killer in Flint, only two of the victims were described as white. According to Chief Locke, the stabber did not rob his victims, leaving investigators with no clear motive for the attacks. We're still trying to nail that down in particular, Locke told AOL News. But we're trying to be responsive to the community and warn the community while we're still gathering that information and putting it together. Locke would not provide an opinion on whether he or his investigators believe the perpetrator was selecting his victims based on race, and would only characterize the victims as vulnerable citizens. Despite the difficulties of the case, Locke told AOL News that he remained hopeful that the case would be solved real soon and urged residents to be extra cautious in the meantime. We just ask them to be careful, Locke said. When they're out by themselves at night and someone wants some help or some information from them, be wary of those individuals and try not to be by themselves. Many of the surviving victims provided police with similar descriptions of their attacker. A white male, between 5 feet 11 inches and 6 feet 2 inches in height, 180 to 210 pounds, with light-colored hair, a goatee, and a muscular build. He was also said to have big feet. A number of witnesses told the police that the suspect had been driving a dark green Chevy Blazer with tan trim. Their description suggested the model year to be between 1995 and 2004. Two of the surviving victims helped Michigan State Police create a sketch of the suspect in which he was depicted as wearing a baseball cap. Meanwhile, the NAACP told the Detroit News that it was concerned about the manner in which the case had been handled and was particularly alarmed that the police had not made the attacks public until August 3, 2010. Why didn't we know about it? Francis Gilchrist, president of the Flint branch of the NAACP, asked a reporter. We didn't know if there's anybody out there stabbing black folk. If it had been in another community, if it had been vice versa, they would have alerted them. Some of the Flint victims said they would have exercised more caution if they had known that a serial killer was in their midst. Police responded that there was little early in the attacks to suggest anything other than the unconnected occurrence of street violence in Flint, a city plagued by unemployment and hard economic times. Profiler Robert Keppel, a retired Washington State homicide detective involved in tracking the Green River Killer and serial killer Ted Bundy, said that he believes the serial stabber stalked and attacked his victims simply for the thrill of it, and that other attacks likely had been committed by the perpetrator prior to the Flint stabbings. He's got a bunch of them, Keppel said. You're going to be trying to track him down in his travels, and probably every place he's been, he's attacked someone. Although the cops and citizens of Flint remained on alert, the stabbings there ceased after the death of Arnold Minor. A day later, however, similar attacks began in Leesburg, Virginia, a small town near Washington, D.C., approximately 600 miles southeast of Flint. Three stabbing attacks in Leesburg occurred in quick succession, according to America's Most Wanted, which featured the violent assaults and a profile of the suspect on its program a short time later, in the hope that it would help identify and apprehend the perpetrator. The first Leesburg victim was Anthony Cage Jr., 15, who was jogging near his home on August 4, 2010, at about 9:30 p.m., according to WILX 10 News, when the driver of a passing vehicle got out and stabbed the unsuspecting teen. The next thing he knows, he feels the stab and the stinging, and he looks back and the guy is running back to his vehicle, said Cage's mother, Virginia Scott Bay Cage. She said that her son collapsed at a nearby gas station. Doctors determined that his liver and kidney had been pierced, but he survived following 3 hours of surgery. The next day, a man driving a green Chevy Blazer was stopped in nearby Arlington on a traffic violation and held for a short time on an old misdemeanor assault arrest warrant. The Blazer was impounded, and police found a knife and a hammer inside. The Blazer's owner was identified as Elias Abuelazam, 33, a legal resident alien from Israel. He was released a short time later after posting bail, and his vehicle was returned to him. At the time of his arrest on the outstanding assault warrant, there was no information available to Virginia police linking him to Anthony Cage's stabbing or the attacks in Michigan. That night, after police released Abuelazam, a 67-year-old Leesburg man was stabbed outside his apartment. Although he lost a kidney in the incident, the man survived. The following day, August 6, 2010, a 19-year-old Leesburg man was struck in the head with a hammer by an unknown assailant after the assailant asked him for help with his vehicle. He too survived the attack, likely because the hammer blow he received had not been a direct hit and he ran away before his attacker could hit him again. A nearby video surveillance camera recorded a person driving a green Blazer through a parking lot only moments before the hammer attack. Two of the Leesburg victims were black, and one was a Hispanic teenager. Each was able to provide the police with a similar description of the man who attacked him, as well as his vehicle, and the descriptions were nearly identical to those provided to police in Flint. By the time police began to piece the information together, Abuelazam was nowhere to be found. Interestingly, all three of the Leesburg attacks occurred near that city's police department. Police believe the attacker surfaced the next day, August 7, 2010, however, in Toledo, Ohio, where church custodian Tony Leno, 59, was stabbed while taking a cigarette break at approximately 7:45 p.m. Leno told police later that a tall, muscular white man had stopped near him in a Chevy Blazer, gotten out, asked him for directions, and then attacked him when he turned to point the direction for the man. Without warning, the assailant stabbed Leno twice in the abdomen. Leno survived, but the assailant fled in the Blazer. By then, police in the various jurisdictions had been working together, believing that they were all looking for the same suspect. "We have been in contact with the authorities in Leesburg, and there are some similarities, specifically an identification that has been able to be obtained from the victims out there, as well as the vehicle description," said Layton. Layton later shared some of his thoughts about the serial stabber on Good Morning America. "It's a very, very violent type of crime," Layton said of the perpetrator's choice of stabbing to inflict injury and death. "Maybe he's enjoying watching them suffer. Maybe he's enjoying watching them wriggle around in pain. But we really don't know what he's thinking, and we won't until we bring him in and talk to him." Although authorities believed they had traced Abuelazam to Ohio, suspecting him to have a connection with the stabbing incident that had occurred there, their prime suspect disappeared again. As the search for Abuelazam intensified, investigators back in Michigan announced that the number of knife attacks attributed to the attacker had decreased by two incidents. In one incident, the victim recanted his statement, and the other was determined to have occurred during a robbery, which was not part of the established modus operandi. "A nationwide intelligence broadcast has gone out, and we're monitoring any incoming information from any state," said Michigan State Police First Lieutenant Patrick McGreevy, head of the task force formed to investigate the attacks. "We don't know what is in his head. What we do know is there has been a string of very, very violent and deadly attacks in Genesee County and attacks in Leesburg that are similar." A tip received just after midnight on Wednesday, August 11, 2010, led investigators to a party store in Mount Morris, Michigan, near Flint, called the Kingwater Market, where Abuelazam worked. He had been employed there since July 5, 2010, and had been hired by the store's owner, Abdullah Farah, who only knew Abuelazam by his first name and had hired him to work the night shift. Because of his large stature, he was nicknamed Big Man at the store. Others called him Eli. Records showed that he's 6'4" tall and weighs about 230 pounds. It was said that Abuelazam drove a green SUV similar to the one described in many of the attacks. Toward the time of the end of the string of violent attacks in Flint, Abuelazam reportedly told Farah that he needed to take time off to travel to Virginia. Some people said that he wanted to relocate to that state. Investigators noted that the attacks in Leesburg began shortly after Abuelazam left his job at the party store. Investigators also learned from a store customer, Edward Gaines, who also told his story to the Detroit News, that Abuelazam had recently shown Gaines injuries to his hands and had reportedly told Gaines that he had received the injuries in a fight. "We were talking a couple of weeks ago, and he showed me his knuckles, his hands," Gaines said. "They were all scratched up. He said he had to do something to somebody. He had scratches on his knuckles and some fingers were taped up." A co-worker, Corky Caldwell, an African-American, told investigators that he had not sensed any racial hostility from Abuelazam. "He could have killed me if he was like that," Caldwell said. "There was no sign of violence in him. He couldn't have been a racist because it's all black people coming in here at night. I didn't see no crazy man at all." Less than 24 hours after receiving the tip about Abuelazam's employment at the party store, investigators, working through the night and talking to his relatives, tracked their suspect to Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport, where they found him late Wednesday evening, August 11, 2010. Abuelazam was waiting at a boarding gate for a flight to Tel Aviv, Israel. Assisted by U.S. Customs and Border Protection officers, investigators had Abuelazam paged over the airport's intercom system, in which he was told to report to a ticket counter. Answering the page, Abuelazam was arrested by the Border Patrol agents without incident. Charged with assault and intent to commit murder in the attack on Antoine Marshall, he was booked into Fulton County Jail to await an extradition hearing. Marshall had identified Abuelazam as his assailant from a photo when the FBI showed up at his house at 3 a.m. that morning. Investigators had tracked him on a flight from Michigan to Louisville, Kentucky, and then to Atlanta, the last leg of his flight before leaving the country for Tel Aviv. The charge for the attack against Marshall would allow investigators to hold Abuelazam as they continued building their case against him for other assaults and killings. Authorities in Michigan also impounded his green Chevy Blazer, which he had left behind, and planned to process it in their search for possible evidence. Abuelazam was also investigated for an alleged stabbing incident in his native Israel earlier in 2010, apparently while there on a visit, reportedly during an argument with a close acquaintance. The police dropped the case, however, because the alleged victim refused to cooperate. Elias Abuelazam waived extradition and was promptly returned to Michigan to face charges. He arrived amid tight security, wearing a bulletproof vest for his own protection. On Thursday, August 26, 2010, the suspected serial stabber appeared via video from jail in the courtroom of Judge Nathaniel Perry III for arraignment on charges of assault with intent to commit murder in the attack of Antoine Marshall. Abuelazam indicated that he understood the charges against him. An automatic not guilty plea was entered for him. No bond was set, and a pretrial hearing was scheduled for Tuesday, August 31, 2010. Genesee County Prosecutor David Layton at that time said that additional charges, including five murder charges, would be filed against Abuelazam as well. Layton said he did not believe the attacks allegedly committed by Abuelazam were racially motivated. "I believe he's not sick," Layton said. "He is evil. The charges will be coming in the homicide cases and the attempted homicide cases. I'll seek life in prison without the possibility of parole." Layton said that he's happy that Abuelazam is back in Michigan. "It's really all about the victims," Layton said. "They have to know that we care. And we do." On September 20, 2010, Abuelazam was arraigned on four additional charges of assault with intent to commit murder and for one charge of murder in the death of Arnold Miner after dried blood found by Michigan State Police in Abulazem's blazer was matched to Miner by DNA testing. Abuelazam hired a new attorney, Christopher M. Smith, who filed an appeal based on the original trial judge's rejection of a motion for a change of venue due to the extensive media coverage of the case, which, they claimed, wrongly called him a serial killer and refuted the judge's decision to allow evidence of the other attacks or testimony of his other alleged victims. On June 10, 2014, the Michigan Court of Appeals upheld Abuelazam's conviction. Smith then appealed that decision to the Michigan Supreme Court, which declined to hear it on November 25, 2014. On August 1, 2014, Abuelazam filed a case in federal court against the Immigration and Naturalization Service and the United States Attorney General, asking to be deported to Israel to face charges of an attempted murder that happened in Latron on August 1, 2009. Michigan authorities believed the lawsuit to be frivolous and expected it to be dismissed, noting that it is legally impossible because of Abuelazam's life without parole status, since convicts cannot be deported until their full sentence is served. On May 2, 2017, Abuelazam confessed to the 2009 murder of Jamie Lane. This happened in Leesburg. Authorities say that with the confession, Abuelazam was granted immunity and would not be charged for Lane's murder. Since being sent to prison, Abuelazam has continued to be disciplined for multiple violent interactions with guards and other inmates, including fights, threats, and possession of a large shank made from plexiglass. He also was in the news in November 2017 when an online dealer claimed to cash in on some of his jailhouse letters. Florida-based Serial Killers, Inc. was selling letters, drawings, photos, and a greeting card from Abuelazam. Abuelazam is currently serving a life sentence in a prison in Ionia, according to the Michigan Department of Corrections.